we, approve one, means uttered, also means spoke. These devas uttered or spoke that. That means, what is it? We use the word that for objectivity. Whatever is objective in this creation, it is uttered by the devas as one of the forms of the Lord. That means, in attempting to utter the name of the Lord, these fellows have uttered out everything into that or objectivity. So we have the objective universe. That means whatever you observe around you, in the beginning stanzas it is said, whatever is there is only the Purusha. So abruvan means uttered or spoke. The next word should be divided into, split into. Yastvayam contains three words. Yaha, tu, tu and evam. Yaha means the one who, that is relative pronoun. Whoever it means. Tu means it is an idiomatic word which indicates, look here, yakute. You look here, one who, evam means thus. You had it in this way. The next word, brahmano, becomes brahmanaha. That means the one who knows the Brahman, the one who knows the Allad. Afterwards, this is used for the, to indicate the priest class called the Brahmins. The word means one who knows the All God like this. Yavam means thus. One should know him like this. That is, look here, one who knows the God like this. Tasya means to him. There is one word, vidyat, knows. Vidyat means knows. Yes, exist. Vidyate means exists. Vidyat means knows. So, one who knows the Lord like this is called a Brahmin. That is what is described here. Tasya, to him, and to such a fellow, deva becomes devaha. The devas, it means the devas again. Asan means existed. Vase means within control. Within control. That means if anyone knows the Lord like this, in this way, he is called a Brahman, and the devas always obeyed him and existed under his control. That means the Deva kingdom fellows, the devas, they willfully obey the fellow who imitates the work of the devas. You know, Pythagoras used a word in Greek, theocracy. That means, kracy means the work of gods. Exactly, Pythagoras said the same thing. One who is engaged in the work of theocracy, will find that the angels of creation live in obedience to him. That is what Pythagoras said. And that is what Socrates also told. One who knows about the God is honored by the angels. And he also said, I believe in God and gods, but I don't believe in the idiotic things they are said to do by others. That's what he said. Socrates. He said, I believe in God and gods, that means devas. But I don't believe in all the idiotic things that they are said to do by others. Now the translation of the stanza. In the beginning, the devas uttered him out as the light, color, sound, syllable, and the name of the Lord. So they uttered him because all these things are himself. Full stop. One who knows him like this is called a Brahmana within brackets. One who possesses the light of self-expansion as the splendor of the highest Lord.
Called a Brahmana.
Brahmana. It is here. Yes, this one. Full stop. Next. The devas wish to obey him and be controlled by him. This is the translation. That means, the more you know about him and about those who work as scouts in his work, that is the devas, the more you know them, the more independence you are given about the laws of nature and the laws of creation. Nature gives us independence according to our fitness. It gives us that much independence for which we are fit. Everyone is kept under the thumb of nature. What is it? Independence of the law. Laws of nature. So, the elements and the planets and all these devas, those who govern the many planes of existence, they keep us under control. And when we are in an individual state, that is the beastly state of existence, they keep us under bondage for our own protection. The more we begin to know and think of the creation and our duties towards others, that is what we call service, then they begin to behave with us with lesser terms of bondage. The terms are changed. Gradually, they become our masters. Instead of the masters of slaves, they will be the masters of the students after a certain stage. And then they will be our friends, guides, and then finally helpers. That is how they behave, these deva fellows. Same thing with the planets also. The more a fellow is primitive, the more his life is predictable according to the horoscope, that is destined. You can very easily predict what the fellow does under such circumstances. He kills. You can say that he kills. He commits murder or he commits suicide. You can very easily predict by seeing the horoscope of a brute. But you can never predict anything if you look into the horoscope of Ramakrishna Paramahamsa or Sri Aurobindo or Ramana Maharshi or Emerson or Immanuel Kant, etc. You can never predict. Why? The planets never condition them. They begin to help them. That's it. You know how many times Gandhi was murdered before he was shot dead by the astrologers? They predicted his death many times. And finally, Gandhi was killed when the planets were sleeping. Nobody predicted that he would be shot dead, because nobody can read the horoscope of such a fellow and predict anything at all. We see astrologers discussing the horoscopes of notabilities. They discuss as things occur. Always it is only a postmortem work. Yeah, astrologers always conduct a postmortem. Why this fellow died according to which planet? That's all nonsense. It is all a technical bluff, a scientific way of bluffing. But real astrology is different. To know when the planets bind us, when they govern us, when they rule us, when they smile with us, when they teach us, when they preach us, and when they advise us, and finally when they begin to help us. All these relationships are there with every fellow for the devas. It is a big headache to these devas, because they have to deal in all these terms with every riffraff on the street, every fellow. But they have no tediousness or disappointment or any complex, inferiority complex, because that's the reason why they are devas. We may have, the doctor may have a hopeless case, but not the devas. So they have uttered like this, and one who knows like this, he becomes, there are two aspects in every one of us. The little I am, that is called individuality, and the I am which is the personality, and finally the I am of the Lord, it's not ourselves. A change takes place in the fellow, and one who utters this, through him the I am of the Lord works. He ceases to be an individual or a personality, and he stands as a branch office to the voice of the Lord. Yes. For example, in sometime in the future, if an administrative center for the whole globe of earth is established, let it be by America or Russia or Israel, we are not concerned. Let it be one global government, and one fellow rules from one place, not in the beastly sense in which we use the word rule, but in the real democratic sense, not according to the present sense of democracy. He begins to rule. Then everyone should have his own capital office, where things are broadcast through video. They will call our friend Robert then to produce things through video and show them at Geneva and India through video. I think tomorrow you are showing the first batch. So under the direction of our Robert B, there will be many offices of the video of the same fellow giving orders and talking, do like this, don't do like this. And then each office will be having sub offices where there are videos. A fellow who has known the Lord like this and who began to utter his name will be one such office instead of a person. He stops to be a person, he begins to be, to live as an institution of God. That's the exact meaning of it. That's why the devas begin to work in every office. It's the first step. It's the first step, because the triangle is the polygon with minimum number of sides. Next, the diamond or the jewel with many triangles will be formed. So this is the meaning of this verse. Here they have shown us a necessity to know the Lord, everyone, and also to know the Lord exactly in the same way as the fellow described in this scripture. And not only knowing, but we should know how to utter it. So he has a business to give us a key, a pass grip and a password for these things. That is the next and the last stanza where this is given. Yes. In that the practical step is given. The word is given. Hrischa te lakshmischa patniyau aho ratre parshve nakshatrani rupam. This is a long vowel. Nakshatrani rupam ishtam manishana. Oh, there is one more. Yes, here there should be still one word. Please add. Asvinav vyattam. This word should be there, here. After nakshatrani rupam, Ashvin. Yes. Yes, up to this, it is the second line. These two lines form the second line. And then Ashvinav vyattam. Then istam manishana. Then amum manishana, sarvam manishana. The word hrischa should be split up into two, hrihi and cha. This means take the name of a person as hri. It is the name, a proper noun, which we will explain. Hri cha means also, and also hri means keep it like that. It is the name of a person. Cha means and also. The word te means to you. Now here the Purusha is directly addressed in the last stanza. O Lord, to you means. This becomes Lakshmihi plus cha. Lakshmi's cha is split up into two words. Lakshmihi cha. Lakshmi is also a proper noun, the name of a person. Cha means and also. Hri and Lakshmi are the names of two persons. Patniyav means two wives. This fellow also has two wives, this Purusha. No. Patniyav. Patri means leaves. No, with R it becomes leaf. That means he has leaves with him. Patniyav. Patniyav means two wives. Patni means wife. Patniyav means jewel number. Two wives. This fellow has two wives. The name of one wife is Hri. The another wife is Lakshmi. So he says, O Lord, Hri and Lakshmi are your two wives. What if? We'll see. What do we get if he has two wives? Yes, we will see. He faces big trouble. Aho means the day. The day. Aho means the day. Ratre means the night. Parshve means sides. Day and night are your two sides, that is the obverse and the reverse. That means if we see you from your face, it is day to us. If we see you from your back, it is your back. So, day and night are your two sides. And then, yes, nakshatrani. Yes. 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 That's only convenience. Nakshatrani means the nakshatras. What is a nakshatra? Nakshatra means the arcs of the ecliptic in astronomy and astrology. See, the whole zodiac from Aries to the end of Pisces has 12 equal divisions. Each is an arc. Therefore, these divisions are called nakshatras. Similarly, we have 27 equal divisions for some other purpose. From Aries 0 to Leo 0, we have 9 equal divisions. From Leo 0 to Sagittarius 0, we have 9 divisions. From Sagittarius to Aries, we have again 9 divisions. They are called the 27 equal arcs or 27 nakshatras. Nakshatra means an equal arc. When the zodiac is divided into any number of equal parts, if they are equally divided, a part is called a nakshatra. You can note down that sentence also if you want. When the ecliptic or the apparent zodiac is divided into a number of equal arcs, then within brackets, whatever the number may be, then close the bracket. Then each arc is called a nakshatra. Each arc is called a nakshatra. The only thing is they should be equally divided. For example, if they are divided from Aries to Libra into two halves, they are called the two nakshatras. If they are made into three, they are called three nakshatras. So, they are divided into 27. There are 27 nakshatras. And they are divided into 28 according to the lunar revolutions. For certain purposes, this zodiac is used with 28 equal divisions. Do you know what for it is used? To know the exact time of fertilization from the birth horoscope. We have what is called the method of rectifying the birth horoscope through the method of the prenatal epoch. Then you require the 28 division zodiac. You can go through the book called Rectification of Horoscopes by E. H. Bailey. She has spent more than 20 years in the maternity hospitals with her stopwatch night and day working to note the exact time to the second of the birth of each child and worked out with each horoscope according to just two stanzas given by a great astronomer of India called Varahamihira, the founder of the system of one-ninths, last night I was referring to. She has taken only two stanzas from his astrology book, which dealt with the relationship between the birth time and the time of fertilization. Varaha Mihira, M-I-H-I-R-A, Mihira. And she worked under her guru called Sepharial, the great astrologer and occultist. She was there with him and she worked. he has given the fundamental rules to her based on Varahamihira. He has worked out some rules and she took the rules of both the gurus and she worked out and she has given us the book called The Prenatal Epoch. The name of the book is The Prenatal Epoch. Her name, author name is E. H. Bailey. E. H. Bailey, you know. For the first time to the West, she has given the division of the zodiac into 28 equal parts, which was there in Varahamihira's and other ancient Indian systems. So, nakshatra means an arc or a division which is one among the many equal divisions of the zodiac. Nakshatrani means the nakshatras or the arcs of the ecliptic. Rupam means form or shape, form. So here he says, the nakshatras are your form. That is the form of the Purusha or Lord. That means the form of every living being, let it be the human being or the monkey or the tiger or the lion or the jackal or the insect or the scorpion or serpent, there is a shape to everyone and the shape is given by the equal number of divisions of the zodiac into a particular form. So, it is your shape, he says. The zodiac and his divisions, they are your shape and your form. So, rupam means form. Ashvinav means the twin devas. The twin devas. You remember, I spoke of the twin devas described as the two horses. They preside over the doubles in nature, that is the twin existences in nature. For example, day and night, and increasing moon and decreasing moon, and also the upper half of the year, that is northern half and the southern half of the year. You know, the sun has his northern journey and southern journey. And incidentally, these two fellows govern the lateral division of your constitution. That is what we call the symmetry. If you have one eye here, you have another eye. If you have one ear here, you have another. One nostril, another nostril. One hand, another hand. So, always you have a symmetry of two on one side and one in the middle. Two eyes and one nose, two nostrils and one tongue, one mouth, like that. Two lungs and one heart, like that we have 2+1, 2+1, 2+1. Along the spinal cord, we have this symmetry. These fellows, these two horses, they work out that symmetry and they govern the lateral sense. That's why they govern the sympathetic nervous system. That means the system of reflexes and instincts. Sympathetic nervous system. Can you tell me what it is? Does it have any sympathy? Pardon? No, no, I want the meaning of the word sympathetic nervous system. Not sympathy. Sympathy, I know, only theory, as a theory. The sympathetic nervous system means, suppose a fellow is having some trouble with one eye. Suppose the doctor asked him to close that eye and manage with the second eye for 4 or 5 days. Is it possible? Why? Why it is difficult? Because there is a sympathetic action between the two eyes. If you close one eye, the other eye also wants to get closed. Or if you open one eye, the other eye also wants to get opened. That's why the doctor has to close it mechanically with a bandage.
The best interest.
Yes, and then he asks you to go on the street. That is what is called sympathetic nervous system. If one side is affected, the other side is automatically affected. Some people there are whose sympathetic system is conditioned. See, if the fellow gets some itching sensation here, he does it like this, but he has to do it like this, this side also. It's a mannerism. It's a mental disease. There are people with this disease. If there is itching here, he does it like this, but he does it like this also, the other side also, like this. Do you know any notable historical person having this in the literature? Any one of you have studied the biography of Johnson, the literate? Yes. Who has written the first big dictionary to English. He was having this disease. He was a very great intellectual. He was going on the streets and touching the poles on either side of the street while walking. Otherwise, he could not walk. He was having this disease. When he touches this with his hand, he has to touch with this hand also. If you take the duster and wipe it, you have to take it into the other hand and wipe it also. Otherwise, you can't proceed further. That's called lateral disease. Karma. Yes. So, the Ashwins, they govern the sympathetic nervous system. That is, which affects automatically both the sides.